Achette Audio presents Born to Be Mild, Adventures for the Anxious, written by Rob Temple and read by Mathew Baynton.
A foreword by Barack Obama. Would be good, wouldn't it? Couldn't get him, unfortunately. Introduction. Ooh, baby, baby, it's a mild world. Mild thing. You make my heart sing. Hey, babe, take a walk on the mild side. Mild horses couldn't drag me away. Born to be mild. What do these lyrics have in common? That's right, they don't exist. The wild and reckless get to be in rock songs, not us, the mild and feckless. But can mild people, those timid worry warts who carry reserve umbrellas in case the main umbrella fails to deploy, still be adventurers? Is it possible to get the same kicks traditionally enjoyed whizzing down Route 66 in a red open-top classic Chevy on the slow lane of the A14 in a grey SUV which scored solid marks across the board for safety and headroom? Is it always necessary to throw the TV out of the hotel window? Isn't leaving the room in the same condition in which you found it just as much of a satisfying anecdote? It's high time someone found out the answers to these burning questions. And seeing as it's my name on the front of this book, hello, I suppose it'll have to be me. But how did I come to be curious about such matters? I'll tell you. A handful of years ago, I moved with my then wife, Ree, to a house on a quiet street in a quiet town and lay quietly in a room for a long time. I used to love an adventure, and I had jobs on magazines, remember magazines? Which provided the opportunity for plenty of them. But when I hit my 30s, I started to become increasingly afraid of the world until I was too frightened to even go outside. I'd been trying to keep fit and active by seeing a personal trainer a few times a week, but eventually I even sacked that off, giving myself completely to being isolated and horizontal. And I had no need to go outside. I'd somehow wangled it so that my job was mostly tweeting, which meant no colleagues, no bosses, no office, no alarm clock, no deadlines. Just me, my phone, and my social media feeds. Doesn't sound too healthy, does it? It wasn't. Everything went bad. Eventually, slowly, with a lot of help, things started to become a little better. Once I'd been dragged out of the rooms I'd trapped myself in, I decided to try to make up for lost time. I wanted to be a bit less poo, bear, and a bit more grills, bear. I needed to set sail for onwards, wherever that was, and unearth the dormant adventurer within. For a bit. For a whole year, in fact. I could do 50 adventures. That's a good number. Much less pleased with itself than 100. Perhaps I'd learn something about myself. Such as, I can actually do a lot of things and enjoy them. I can't do anything without panicking and I'm better off not trying. Some kind of middle ground between the above. I've overreached myself with a fourth bullet point. To be honest, I had no idea what I was doing. I just knew I had to do something. Hopefully you'll have as much fun reading about my adventures, gentle attempts to find a hobby, as I experienced going on them, i.e. a moderate amount of fun at times. Strap in then, please. Pithy joshing and pretty standard start of book banter aside, please do always strap in when inside a moving vehicle. I know I'm not your mum, but it is for your own good and it's also the law. It's gonna be a mild ride. Rob. 1. I've got a room booked under the name Temple. Temple? Yes, that's the one. I'm in Barcelona, where I know I've booked a room, so I'm not sure why I sound so suspicious of myself. Come to think of it, the lady on reception seems suspicious of me. Maybe I'm not Mr. Temple. In which case, who am I? Aha, yes, Temple. Robert, yes? She says to the computer. That's me. I nod and we both allow ourselves a chuckle of relief. We've cracked the case, solved the puzzle. It's a curious game. It's the first time I've left home for months, a particularly debilitating episode of ill health, the mental kind, leading to the physical kind, has had me recuperating, or wallowing, safely, or dangerously, behind the curtains. If I'm going to reboot myself as an intrepid adventurer, the ability to travel solo seems mandatory. It's to adventuring what being able to carry a heavy bag is to armying. I've never really travelled. I've been to a fair few places, from Tenby to Tokyo, but I haven't travelled in the dating profile, gap year, beaded bracelets up to the elbow sort of way. Nor have I travelled solo, apart from on the press trips of yonks ago, but then you always meet up with the usual crew of journos on those anyway. Press trips are basically just going to the pub by plane. So I've hurled my precious collection of caution to the wind and whooshed to Barcelona on a whim, despite generally being pretty deficient in whim. Now, sitting on the end of one of two tightly tucked twin hotel beds, shoes lined up under a desk, pants and socks in the most suitable drawers and passport in the safe, staring at my reflection in the black screen of the Philips telly, I'm hoping my whim replenishes itself enough to let me at least leave the room before it's time to fly home. A few days earlier. "Come and look at this," says Mum. Mum says a lot of things to me these days, as does Dad, because I've recently moved back in with them. She's found another video of a cat on her iPad. She loves her iPad. And cats. "No, it's okay, I'm not really interested," I reply, immediately feeling disappointed in myself for not simply looking. "You're not interested in anything."
"I am."
"Like what?"
I don't know, jogging. I could always get back into jogging, I suppose. Bit cold, though.
Or I could become a travelling man.
Yes, I'll go travelling. On my own.
Are you sure that's a good idea?
Yeah, I think I could become a travel man.
On your own?
Yeah.
Who with?
Just me, seeing the world like Richard Iowadi in that Travel Man show.
Don't forget he's got a camera crew, and he goes with someone. And he gets paid for it.
I'll be fine.
So what will you do while travelling?
Oh, loads of stuff. I'll take life by the horns.
Good. You be careful. Horns are dangerous. I'm 35. It's about time I became interested in something. Got some purpose and direction instead of blindly bumbling around my life as if it's someone else's kitchen. I've taken to skulking through life, quietly puzzled, hesitant to make a fuss, an intern in my own existence. But what to do? There are so many things. The world is my oyster. I hate oysters, they make me sick. Goa, Bali, Thailand. They're all so far away and expensive and probably stuffed with the bracelet people. Where should I go? Where's good in January? I spin the globe and after a few attempts manage to make my finger land on Spain. Then, once it has, I manoeuvre the finger, index of course, I'm not mad, deftly down to Barcelona. It's close enough to home and I've been there many times. Good. I'll post myself there. Booking a last minute ticket, I head straight out to buy a travel bag. Well, not straight out. I still have a few days until the departure date. I'm not going to book properly last minute, what with all the mini toiletries, airport parking, route planning, insurance and other bits of admin I have to complete. I also have to visit Office World as I'm fresh out of transparent plastic document wallets. I also like to have a few days cushion to decide whether I want to abort this or any idea or not. Present me is always busy having to cancel all the stuff that past me thought would be fun to arrange. If I'm considering doing something wild and spontaneous, I make sure to thoroughly plan it out first. I visualise the whole scenario, summoning up as much negative energy as possible. If potential pros of the adventure outweigh the cons, which is rare, only then will I greenlight the scheme. Only then can I start worrying about it properly. There's a few rucksacks and holdalls in TK Maxx,
but they don't seem like they'd withstand a bashing should Ryanair decide I deserve the privilege of unexpectedly having my cabin bag chucked in the hold, like the last time I went on holiday. Not that this is a holiday, this is travelling. I can't stress that enough.
But it's my cabin bag, I'd argued. It has all my cabin stuff in it.
But we're giving you access to the hold for free, came the reply. There's nothing like the gift of being forced into a situation you don't want. There'd be no moisturising my face, cleaning my teeth, reading all 5 autobiographies, or changing my socks on that 2-hour flight. Those dreams were suffocating under the weight of other people's massive suitcases in the hold, and I was quietly livid. Also, I'm doubtful these soft bags TK Maxx has a glut of meet Ryanair's regulations. Sure, one of these so-called travel bags would fit the size testing box thing in the airport if squished, but should it be full to capacity and therefore unsquishable, I'd be in trouble. The 30-centimetre shatterproof ruler I have with me is screaming under the hot glare of the shop lights, "Do not buy this bag!" So, despite the risk of not looking very traveller-y, I'm going for this smart navy wheelie case made by Antler, complete with combination lock. Off to Superdrug then, just a few shops down in Huntington's Big Store Square, for my mini toiletries and, ooh, what's this? A zip-up transparent toilet bag designed for flight. Sold.
Flying somewhere? Asks the man manning the till, who seems to have asked his tattooist for one of everything.
Yes.
Nice one. I hate flying myself.
Get someone else to do it then?
Yeah, me too. I'm always scared the plane's going to burst into flames.
Righto.
My last stop is at Clifford's the Chemist in God Manchester, just down the road from home, to pick up my thyroid medicine. I don't have a thyroid anymore, so if I don't take pills, I slowly swell up to the size of a mattress and then slip into a coma and die. This nearly happened at a wedding. I fell asleep in the corner of a pub for hours. The doctor told me that my body had gone into hibernation mode, like a turtle, and it was a wonder I woke up. I should probably pick up some Pro Plus while I'm at the chemist, and mosquito spray, and some lip balm, and maybe some antihistamine.
Plasters?
Ding-a-ling, sounds the bell on the weathered white wooden door just off the mini roundabout to the left of the Chinese bridge.
Be with you in a minute,
beams the pharmacist as she rushes to the far shelf to pick up a packet of 4 toilet rolls. The room smells of lemon lockets. I'm so sick of playing Russian roulette in that bloody toilet, I'm going to do something about it. We both laugh conspiratorially and roll our eyes as she thumps off back up the stairs while I remain awkwardly rooted by the generous selection of plastic pillboxes. I have no idea what she means. It's a couple of very early trains, I quickly decided against the hassle of driving / parking, to the airport. Huntington to Peterborough, Peterborough to Stansted. It's January cold. I perch on the thin, freezing bench, on my arse, not like a canary, and tense everything, retracting into myself like a spooked whelk, while teenagers in school blazers chirp in sarcastic bursts and giggles around me. Peterborough Station, the only conversation I ever hear about Peterborough involves the station.
Oh yeah, I know Peterborough, I had to go to the station once.
Is full of folks on their way to the office, most of them looking like ticket collectors thanks to those black, baggy, strappy laptop bags. Boarding an end carriage of the empty Stansted train as the sun rises over the city. Yes, it's a city, it has a cathedral. I'm tremendously relieved to find my reserved aisle seat is available. Once I'm nestled in the plush but stained ruby-red bucket chair that looks like it's from a 1970s adult cinema, a round-headed fellow, a small face drawn in the dead centre of a taut balloon, who's holding a croissant and smells strongly of B&H, as if he's got a collection of half-smoked ones in his pocket, boards and, oh God, talks to me. He says he'd prefer to sit in my seat rather than in his assigned window seat. I've reserved this, I'm afraid. There are loads of free seats, though, I say as I gesture to an empty carriage.
Maybe if no one gets on later, I could sit in your seat, he counters through his tiny little mouth, which is perfect for smoking. I'm stumped as to what kind of offer he thinks he's working with here, so I stay quiet. Eventually he goes away but leaves the smell of old tobacco behind, which is surprisingly quite comforting. The sky over Cambridgeshire glows red like Campari. Sight and smell and warmth combine, sending tingles up my neck. I feel an almost morphine-like wooziness wash through me. The first leg of a journey complete and out of my hands, I remain comfortably numb as the train slides me gently towards London. Not even the sight of Tobacco Man standing up to let a scatter of pastry flakes fall from his chest onto the floor manages to get my goat. Much. Stansted is busy with travellers in dark coats and red scarves, apart from one lady in a dressing gown, spending their Christmas money trudging wearily around like Lowry people. I wonder how I've been allowed once again to go through an airport unchaperoned, reminding myself that it's because I'm apparently an adult. In the queue for boarding, the chap in front of me, who looks just like a longer, thinner Ian Duncan Smith, is doing full-on running stretches for a good 20 minutes. His wild lunging really starts to irk me. Waiting until he's balancing on one leg, stretching out his quads, I consider giving him a gentle push, but then worry that I might get tasered. Christ, I'm knackered. Drained from running on fake bravado all morning, from trying to walk with a sense of purpose, exhausted from attempting to not look constantly lost, and through forcing myself to speak clearly and at a volume higher than my usual mumble. Bumbling Bernard is one of my characters, but it's not right for this situation. To get to the plane from the front door, I have to be Confident Colin. It's important to look like you have a clue what you're doing to match everyone else doing the same. Flight 1234 is ready for boarding. Please make your way to the departure gate. All travellers on Flight 1234 to Barcelona are already at the departure gate. We've been here for ages, but determined to respond to the instruction in some token way, we stand a bit straighter, realign our rucksacks on our shoulders, and shuffle forward an inch or two. Go, go, go! My brain is shouting at my heart to race and for my legs to shake, but the propranolol I took in Itsu keeps my body in neutral. I wish I'd taken it earlier for when security deemed my zip-up transparent toilet bag, designed for flight, completely unsuitable for flight, cheers Superdrug, and handed me a much smaller transparent bag that would help keep the plane in the sky. If every day is a school day, then today's lesson is that toothpaste will react to trying to be stuffed into something small and tight by ejaculating all over your arm. I sit in my aisle seat and watch everyone file on with their wheelie cases the size of refrigerators and spend the flight staring open-mouthed at a snaggle-toothed, Einstein-haired man, clearly 30 to 40 years away from being a child, but nonetheless dressed like some sort of beach-bum toddler, who considers it perfectly acceptable to read a book while idly digging into various bits of his head before crumbling whatever he excavates between his fingers, casually seasoning the floor with his bodily waste. I dream of clicking his seat belt buckle mid-flight and opening the door. I dream this all the way to Spain, where I'm glad to be off the aircraft, which I feel should now be placed in a hospital toxic waste bin. I hit the empty taxi rank at Barcelona Airport. No taxi? No taxi. No taxi. So, no taxi. Cab? No taxi. It doesn't seem to matter how many times I have it confirmed there are no taxis. The taxi situation simply refuses to resolve. Finally, the penny drops. No taxis. Right, time to move directly to the fifth stage of grief and accept that I have to find a train or, good lord, a sodding bus into the city. Breathe. I am Columbus. After studying the train map for about half an hour, I deduce that every train which leaves Barcelona El Prat Airport appears to go somewhere into the middle of the main bit, which is roughly where my hotel lives. So I hop on one of them and hop off half an hour later,
at Passage de Gracia, walking a further half an hour in the Catalan winter sunshine. Phone now switched to Movistar. I Instagram a few things along the way, a road sign, my own face in sunglasses, a fountain, to persuade people I'm happy, and amble past swarms of on-strike black and yellow cabs, colossal metal bumblebees in search of a giant peach, to the Hotel Universal. It's a very plain hotel, the type of place you go for a conference. I thought about getting a B&B, but every time I do that, I seem to end up becoming part of a family for the duration of my stay. A trip to Norfolk had the husband explaining to me that his wife likes to stay in a dark room watching tennis all day. Never saw her. So I was welcome to hang out with him. I didn't actually see much of him in the end, as he kept having to pop to the woods. Just outside the main door of the hotel, a man with an Irish accent asks to borrow my phone. I was DJing up in the mountains and now I've come to call me mother. It's not the most convincing story I've heard. I'm really sorry I can't give you my phone, I reply. I'm going in this door now, sorry. He tells me to piss off, which is surely what I'm already doing, and to go and have sex with myself, on my list. There was a kid at my school who at the age of 8 swore blind. He invented the insult, piss off. Mad to think it's made it all the way to Barcelona. Anyway, I'm here with my little suitcase. I have arrived. I have a room booked. Coke, hash, blowjob? I'm asked by a young brunette lady in black high heels, tight blue jeans and an oversized pink puffer jacket, as I'm on my way, layered up against the chill, down the dark gothic quarter streets off La Rambla, for dinner at a restaurant that specialises in snails. I've been holding myself hostage in the hotel for a day and a night and another day, only letting myself out once to go to the supermarket next door. I used up so much energy summoning the gall to leave the safety of my room to journey to the solitary safety of another room that I'm now spent. Life would be fine if it was just going from room to room. The outside world, with all its people and wide open space, really does throw a spanner in the works. Coke, hash, blowjob. Certainly not in that order, I think. Hurrying head down past the bright mobile phone shops of Carrer dels Escudelles. No, that just personally wouldn't be workable. I first came to Los Caracoles with my partner at the time, Gemma, about 10 years ago, but we had to leave because fish soup, a big plate of monstrous boiled slugs, not the French garlicky morsels, these were nightmarish giant snot creatures, and a vicious hangover had me feeling delirious and sweaty, my mind as wonky as a Dali clock. You enter the place through a door, classic, into a bar, which you walk through into the kitchen, which leads into a reception area, then through to ever-deepening caves of dining rooms. You stop at each leg of this journey to say to someone, anyone, I have a reservation? This person then seems completely shocked / put out to see a customer or to have it suggested that the place is even a public eating establishment at all. It's as if you're walking into a series of strangers' living rooms and asking for supper. It also seems to be a rule here that every waiter be a cross, bald man. Some online reviewers have typed their opinion that it's a tourist trap. I knew all this, but after spending a day online looking for a hip new joint in which to feast on the latest in Catalan cuisine, alone, I became paralysed by choice. The waiter takes my order, not looking at me, my menu, or even his own pad as he writes, but instead gazing angrily across the room like he's having a flashback to a nightmarish childhood trip to the seaside. I feel on edge, unable to get warm. I'm stiff-necked and stranded. One small sip of wine would melt all the unease away. Yes? I'll have... I panic. The fish soup. Yes? Oh, more? Okay, I'll have some fries as well. Fritas? Yes? That's it. That's it. That's it. One soup, one fritas. Yes, please. Nothing else? Just another Coke would be great. He whisks the wine glasses away as if they've answered him back once too many times, and he now intends to give them a damn good thrashing once he's alone with the pair of clinky bastards. The soup, rich with shell juice, is the type of curry powder / turmeric colour that really stains white linen when splashed about by a shaky man's spoon. Soon the tablecloth looks like someone's shot the yellow Teletubby in the back of the head over it. The soup costs more than this specific soup should. The fritas never arrived. Time to scurry away. Bedways is rightways, as they say in A Clockwork Orange, though I'm sure they got that from my mum. My supermarket trip has provided me with Milka chocolate, which I kept in my mind throughout the meal as something to look forward to, a ton of gummy sweets, paprika crisps, 2 bottles of water, a new mini toothpaste, and a block of hard white vacuum-packed cheese that I keep in the minibar fridge perched atop 2 cans of Estrella, and which I later open most horrifyingly with mini toenail clippers. My only other meal out is in the hotel restaurant a short ride up in the lift. The Wolf Tavern doesn't know if it wants to be an Italian deli, a British pub, an American diner, or a sports bar, so it combines elements of all of them to create a weird whole that's none of them. It's already half set up for breakfast in the morning, which is a bit depressing. I feel more self-conscious than usual, as back in my room I mistook my toothpaste for lip balm and smeared Colgate all over my mouth. Now I'm having my doubts as to whether I got it all off. Are you ready, perhaps, for something to eat? Yes, please. Is it okay to order a chicken Caesar salad, but is it also okay to have some croquettes on the side? Salad and croquettes. If that's okay. Anything else? No. Gracias. A lower division Spanish football match plays on one of the large tellies, which gives me something to stare at, although I don't hear the match because the tellies are all on mute while Shania Twain's Man, I Feel Like a Woman plays through loudspeakers. And technically, I don't even really watch the match, I just stare in its general direction and pretend to watch, meaning I'll eat my meal with my head turned 90 degrees to the left, so that anyone else who might enter the otherwise empty room won't think I'm just there to do something as deviant as eat alone at 7 p.m. No, I'm here for the sport, thank you. I'm annoyed with myself. Why can't I just relax and have a laugh? I used to have a lot of laughs. Now I just feel like I'm constantly killing time. It would be easier if I was pissed. Yay, my salad is being carried towards me. Time to sit up a bit more and re-straighten my knife and fork, then move them outwards a bit more so the plate doesn't accidentally clank on them. I straighten a tie that isn't there, flatten my shirt over my belly and prepare to say, "That's lovely, thank you, great stuff, gracias." The salad is in some kind of black plant pot with KFC-style fried popcorn chicken, iceberg lettuce that seems to have been fed through a paper shredder, and the dressing in an artful Z shape across the top, as if, with a flourish, Zorro has jizzed on my meal. Olé! Why is hotel food so weird? Trying to please everyone, I suppose. The table next to me fills up with 5 suits who start discussing business in the hope of pleasing someone called Roger, who's apparently not happy. Now all I can do is listen to them. There must be over 30 tables in here, and they choose the one next to me. One of their satchels is touching my thigh, and a man with stubble you could sand a beach on is eyeing up my croquettes while rubbing his bicep. Maybe if I give him a stare. Nope, that was a bad idea. Couldn't commit to it, ended up turning it into a smile. Quick, look to the ceiling. Look everywhere and smile. You're just a smiley guy enjoying the ambience. I must look bonkers. What am I doing? This is just awful. I must leave. I feel like I might faint. Are my hands going blue? I think my hands might be turning blue. I ask if I can take the croquettes back to my room, party time, as if requesting nuclear codes. Of course, says the waitress. Of course. And I scuttle away with my little cellophane side plate and get in bed fully clothed. I shouldn't have come here. I don't sleep well during my stay because it's chilly in the room. I know there are extra blankets in the wardrobe, I've seen them, but I never quite manage to give myself the push to get up and unfold them. Instead, I lie there for half the night, just a tiny bit too cold for comfort, thinking about getting the blankets. This sort of thing has always been a problem. I let small things build until they form a stack that feels unmanageable. I allow bills to pile. I live for years with computer viruses, working my way around them with an ever-diminishing array of workable computer functions at my disposal. If a letter disappeared from my keyboard, I'd use words that don't rely on it. I survived a whole year with a laptop that insisted on speaking French. Some of it is laziness, mixed with the illogical belief that if I don't do anything, then nothing can go wrong. Also mixed into the concoction that makes up my uselessness is an ever-present urge to self-sabotage. Historically, as soon as life seems to be trundling along quite harmlessly, I'll try to make it all a bit more exciting. I'll try to make a change to spice things up a bit, and that change will almost without exception be rash, ill-thought-out, against all sensible advice, and not at all conducive to maintaining a healthy mental outlook. I get trapped in hotel rooms. I'm ready to leave 2 hours before checkout, in this instance heavily sugared up with frutella, but I'm unable to exit a room unless it's bang on the deadline, which isn't helpful for the cleaners. I'm worrying about how I've been too scared to make this trip interesting. Miles, 1,000. Anecdotes, nil. Outside is all the world, a stage, apparently, and I'm here, frozen in the wings. "Can we get you a taxi?" asks the receptionist. "No, thank you, I'll be fine." It takes me half an hour of wandering back alleys before I locate a cab. My remaining euros go towards a Barcelona FC pencil case from the airport for my nephew James, which I study while sat in a restaurant. "Come on! Come on, come on, come on!" shouts the laminated A4 poster taped to the wall. The place is full of happy couples sipping mini bottles of screw-top carver. Actually, only one couple is doing that, but loudly. Have you ever looked directly upwards while sat in an airport pub or cafe? It's all steel beams and girders and corrugated roofing. Feels like you're on a film set. I'm waiting for the director to shout action so I can get my small part over with. My flight is called and I journey home. My first adventure in the bag, wheelie case, with few tales to tell. 2. It's not until you have a desire to do yoga that you notice just how much the country's stuffed with it. Every other building in the UK has people of all shapes and ages in lycra bending themselves silly and trying not to parp. And we're all destined to do it at least once. It's the jury duty of exercise. My time has come. I've summoned myself. Why yoga? Well, you see, I've always wanted to be a Zen guy. As a young teen, I used my pocket money to buy peace symbol necklaces on family holidays. I had a Best of Bob Marley CD. I painted my bedroom brown and burned incense. I even attempted to smoke incense through a pipe, which burned my throat terribly, though not as savagely as the cinnamon stick. Or the purple haze legal high my friend Jazz and I smoked on a wall in our school uniforms, an old lady calling us naughty boys as the loosely rolled joint went up in flames like dry hay, probably what it was, and disappeared our fluffy moustaches, which at the time really harshed our vibes. Excuse me while I miss the sky. I'd like to recapture those hippie aspirations in a healthier, less stupid way. Where to find yoga round here? This requires the help of the splendid God Manchester Living Facebook page. I'm addicted to it. Nothing shows the strengths, gripes, heart and hilariousness of a town like the community Facebook page. It's a digital town hall where everyone's invited. A place where the town's residents rush to say they've stepped in dog mess, or to offer someone a lift to the hospital, or to thank someone for helping them park. To say someone shifty's going round in a van, or to ask about the A14,
or to state that a delivery driver has thrown their parcel in a pond, or occasionally just to say something a little bit uncomfortable. My favourite posts recently have been about 1, a turtle that keeps escaping, and 2, a friendly seal who lives in the nature reserve, though not everyone was delighted with the seal's presence. He'll eat all the fish. Another personal favourite, is this anyone's chicken? God Manchester Living finds me a weekly evening yoga group in the neighbouring village of Hartford, which I often drive through en route to the nearest 24-hour Big Tesco, and I pay for 6 beginner sessions. The initial instructions advise against trying to access the building via a certain long, thin lane, so I do exactly this, eventually having to reverse all the way back. Extracting myself backwards down this muddy track without destroying my car is more tense than a game of Operation. The printout also advises me not to drive too far into the car park in the dark, else there's a high chance I'll go straight into the river. It's a stressful journey. I'll need some yoga by the time I arrive. Turning off my engine, thankfully with no water around the pedals, I'm just in time to witness an odd exchange between 2 women in gym kits who I assume are here for the same reason as I am. "Do you want me to guide you in?" says the helpful lady in the already parked shiny white 4x4. She's prim and manicured, in her 50s perhaps, looking as if she's journeyed out for a posh lunch but has capriciously veered right to a random church hall in the hope of a good old stretching. "No, I was a driving instructor for 10 years, comes the curious and curt reply from the less glam, no-nonsense woman with hair like mine in the hatchback, who does some kind of 6-point manoeuvre to reverse park into a random area of this large square of empty nothing. There aren't any bays or lines, just ground. Perhaps she can see some markings that the rest of us can't. I mean, she had been a driving instructor for 10 years, a fact she repeats a further 2 times before we get into the building, then twice more once we do. I said I've been a driving instructor for 10 years, love, I don't need help parking. "Oh, hello, love, sorry, I didn't mean to be rude out there, it's just I used to be a driving instructor, so I'm quite used to parking." If she was my driving instructor, not only would I know it, but I'd make damn sure I passed my test first time. I wouldn't want to disappoint her. Everyone else has mats under their arms, I notice, and towels. I feel quite naked just standing here in my running kit and bright red flip-flops. I'm nervous and concentrate on smiling politely and chuckling whenever anybody, all older women, says anything. Bloody hell, I'm shaking. They all speak entirely in jokey complaints, the punchlines of which seem to consist solely of eye rolls and saying, "I don't know, eh?" I hand over my payment to the instructor, Emmy, with shaky hands like I'm paying for drugs. "Got any downward dog?" She lends me a mat. We spread ourselves out, as instructed, our mats, our little personal islands in the sea, and spend the next hour desperately trying not to accidentally look at anyone else's arse, which is tricky when you're surrounded by them. Emmy's really chilled, as you'd expect, I suppose. It'd be worrying to have a really uptight yoga instructor. And makes us comfortable and encourages us to move at our own pace, wobbly and slow being the most favoured speed. She looks like she does a lot of yoga. That is, toned, bendy, and possessing of a peaceful aura. I bought my gym kit a few years ago to grow into, which I've done rather too enthusiastically, especially since I gave up on personal training last year. I'm like dough wrapped in cling film, proving in a cupboard. I start to do some casual stretches in preparation for the hour-long casual stretch-a-thon about to commence, though I think I might be wrong to do so. But as Emmy says, there's no wrong way to do things here. I like it when someone says that. It makes me want to push the good faith implied in the statement to the limit, to fire up Netflix on my phone and get out a ham sandwich in the middle of the session. This is because I'm childish. "Sorry I'm late. Traffic was terrible," says the harassed lady who bustles in late. That's okay, just grab a space. You haven't missed much at all, says Emmy peacefully.
I got stuck on that bloody ring road just before the turnoff, harassed lady continues, hoovering up any burgeoning bits of zen with every word.
I smile 3 or 4 times when I think she's about to look at me, but each time it's a false alarm. I'm shaking even more now. Still ages to go. Time is taking forever.
There are 6 or 7 of us, the largest class Emmy has taught so far. On one side of the hall, which smells faintly of hymn book sweat and coffee breath, all church halls smell the same, a smell I can only term, perhaps owing to a disappointing vocabulary, as a bit churchy, is a big window looking out onto a graveyard.
Just ignore them, Emmy says as we turn to face the rows of stones.
Ignore them? Maybe we could learn from them. Can't get more relaxed than them, really. In many ways, they've reached peak yoga.
There are so many joints popping in the room, it sounds like we're going gung-ho with a box of Christmas crackers.
Despite the plinky-plonky hippie chill-out coming from the chubby little portable plastic CD player, the grey type with the flimsy carry handle and random bits of neon blue, the atmosphere in the room isn't overly relaxed, if I'm honest. But then we are all beginners.
The lady next to me keeps doing the rolling her eyes and tutting thing, which I do back to her as if we're asking each other, "What's this all about, hey? What are we doing here?" And the woman who used to be a driving instructor keeps stating that she can't do yoga because of her sciatica.
If there are any parts that make you feel uncomfortable or that you don't want to try, that's absolutely fine, Emmy gently stresses, prompting a long response about troublesome elbows.
My back hurts and my legs seem to be made of jelly. I nearly had a stroke trying on some skinny jeans in a big Tesco fitting room the other day. At least I think they were skinny jeans, perhaps they were regular jeans, and I have fatty thighs. This feels a bit like that. The main sounds in the room, other than cracking, are "Ooh!" and "Bloody hell!" I've gone all light-headed. I'm greying out. I need to lie down. Hang on, I am lying down.
Yoga, or at least my attempt at yoga, has managed to make lying down, my favourite thing, seem difficult.
Everyone starts having a conversation about how the classes is an inconvenient time, as if it's compulsory community service yoga.
I'll have to have my dinner at 9 p.m. I only finished work an hour ago,
before someone's car alarm goes off for the remaining half an hour.
Sorry, I think that might be mine, says the woman who belongs to the arse in front of me, although she doesn't check if it definitely is indeed her BMW that's wailing through the wall.
How's everyone feeling?
Emmy asks, receiving the awkward and inevitable response of complete silence.
That's excellent.
I'm feeling white and weak, like I've simultaneously lost all my blood sugar and had 10 espressos. After 5 minutes of pretending to sleep, I gather my things, wave goodbye to the room and speed out the door as if late for an important meeting. Leaving the car park, I pull out straight into a traffic jam. The radio keeps switching itself on and off, and I look at my watch while holding a half-full can, resulting in warm, flat Diet Coke spilling over my crotch.
Good.
I don't think I'm built for yoga, I tell my parents while getting some crisps from the cupboard.
Stop eating crisps, shouts Mum. You won't get slim eating crisps. Anyway, tea will be ready soon.
What are we having?
I don't know, replies Mum. Depends on what you're making.
What's that on your shorts? Looks like you've wet yourself.
I could get sausage and mash from the co-op.
Yes, that'd be nice. Dad likes that. Don't forget to buy gravy. You like that, don't you, Paul?
What's that? Sausages and mash. You like that, don't you?
Yes, lovely. I like anything.
Righto, I say, scrubbing myself with a baby wipe, which makes matters damper. Any sausage preference?
Ooh, I quite like those Colombian ones.
Mum's stumped me with this one.
I work out in the co-op that she must mean Cumbrian. It's a good job she's not a drug baron ordering 50 kilos of finest Cumbrian cocaine. "Just these, please, mate," I say to the young chap at the counter. "How are you doing today?" "I'm alive and kicking, thank you, sir. Can't ask for more than that." "I suppose not." As I fork mash into my mouth, I wonder, perhaps I'm just too het up to ever be zen. Perhaps I don't try hard enough. Trying to be zen seems like an oxymoron, but I suppose even relaxing takes work. I used to seek out extreme challenges, ultramarathons, that sort of caper. That year or two of endless jogging nearly a decade ago was, I think, the most relaxed and happy I've been. But it was a bit unsustainable, mostly for my knees. Maybe yoga is too relaxing to relax me. As I squeeze some more ketchup onto the edge of my plate, on top of the HP, English mustard and chilli sauce that's already there, I love a condiment, I think that maybe I need to suffer over a 50-mile jog with blood seeping from my nipples to feel truly chilled. 3. Home is Godmanchester, that place I've already mentioned a few times, which, unless you're from Godmanchester, has made you think, what in the name of hell is a Godmanchester? Is it like a Wonderwall? Is it a superior Manchester? No, Godmanchester is a pretty town in Cambridgeshire. It's like the setting for a gentle children's cartoon full of shopkeepers and postmen. You could have a wonderful life here. It has four pubs, the White Hart, the Royal Oak, the Exhibition, which is next to the house with the tree that spills figs on Erning Street, and the Black Bull, a few cafes and two co-ops. There's a family-run butcher's, a fishing tackle and trophy engraving shop, a riverside chippy, where the owner at the time angrily threw a saveloy at my head, Bellman's, the sandwich place, a couple of newsagents, an Indian restaurant called Planet Spice, and a Chinese restaurant called Chinta. Ducks, geese and swans, Union Jack bunting in summer, a big Christmas tree in winter, and the Chinese bridge that appears in about 95% of all photographs taken of the place. The town's own magazine is called The Bridge. It often has a picture of the bridge on the cover. Godmanchester loves occasions. Halloween is a big thing here, as is the summer fete and bonfire night. The community has already started preparing for Remembrance Sunday, and it's only February. It's a close community, really, a small one. I once stood in the queue at Roman Gate, the surgery, and my neighbour was behind me and my sister-in-law in front. "What are you here for, then?" "Oh, just ill, you know," I said as I slid my scrap of paper with anxiety written on it in shaky letters to the receptionist. "It's 22 minutes to Cambridge by car and an hour to King's Cross by rail from the adjoining larger town of Huntingdon." Ree and I met at the gadget magazine we worked at 10 years ago, marrying 4 years later, and set up home in Balham. 5 years ago, we bought a house in Godmanchester to try to start a family with a bit of affordable space. Now I live temporarily with my parents just down the road. I say temporarily, it's been about a year. Or maybe two now? I can't remember, every day is the same. I remember I was living by myself in February 2018, which was when my mental health really took a nosedive during the beast from the east which covered the country in thick snow. After that, for a while, my own sense of time became unreliable. It's very peaceful at Mum and Dad's. They have a wonderful apple tree that creates enough crumble to last all winter. We're only halfway through the last batch. Some people struggle to move back in with their parents, but I've perhaps found it a bit too comforting for my own good. Mum and Dad are very zen, but then they have quite a set routine which they don't enjoy deviating from. They maintain their zen with rigorous planning. A lot of training and rules seem to go into being relaxed. They've given me stability when I'd become a train so far off the rails I was upside down in a cow field, and I'll always be grateful for it. Plus, while I'm here, I can help with cooking, shopping and heavy lifting, so I think they're as happy with the current deal as I am. I've driven to our house, or the marital home, as solicitors call it, to check for post, most of which is addressed to Mr. Pizza Lover. No matter how long the house sits cold and empty, and how much multi-purpose flash is sprayed, it still smells of last year's life, now as dead as the chilli plants in the garden. It smells of Raffy, our Burmese mountain dog who died at 2 from a spinal stroke. I don't like to stay in this house for too long. It's the scene of a breakdown. Memories collide with the dust catching in my eyes and throat like pollen. Clutching my wedge of takeaway menus, which I'll enjoy reading later, I look at the grey sofa. Everything in this house is grey, or elephant dung, or Weimaraner sigh, or whatever it was we picked. The last time I was sat on that sofa, a few days after my old friend Andy, we bonded at school over both trying to be hippies, had visited and cleaned the place up, taking out all the empties and clearing up the smashed glass and overflowing bins and cooked me some pasta. I felt so glum and done in that my chest started to physically hurt, like I was being repeatedly stabbed with a rusty tent peg. It turned out to be acute pancreatitis. If you've never had it, I wouldn't bother if I were you. It really, really hurts. Imagine someone trying to remove the contents of your torso using only a rock and a shard of glass. If you did wish to get it, the quickest way that I know is to...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.